Morning. It's Tuesday 25th of May. I've been back to work for a couple of days, or nights tonight, so I've got a couple of nights. And then I'm going to be going back up Thursday afternoon, doing Thursday, Friday night up Burghfield for a couple of nights. So looking forward to that. At home now, I thought it might just be an idea to, talking about the lake all the time. I thought it'd be an idea maybe to show you this is the old bookshelf. I was going to show you Nigel Sharp's book. Down here is a map of the lake. Nice. Yeah, in here is a map of the lake. It might give people a better idea what I'm going on about when I'm trying to describe swims and whatever. If I lay this out. Zooms in nicely. So yeah, the fishing over the last month, I've been up this end, you know. I started off doing a bit here on Bond Point. Sort of, this has been opened up a bit more this year, this no carp bay, and we can fish sort of halfway up to here. And then from there, all the way around here, all the way around to here. That's the bit we call the out of bounds. So it's this section of water here. That's where they've spent a lot of time. There's the old ski run they seem to love jumping in. And this is the section of water we can't get to, where they seem to like. Around here, Alsatian. This is a bit shallower. Apparently they get up there at times. I'm sure they will at some point. This is the area where I was fishing the Murders swims. I think it says Murders there, but I think this is an older map, obviously. So yeah, it looks more like what they call a little compound now. But Murders is this bit out here. There's a couple of swims here. One fishing out in front of this island, and one fishing out to the front of this island. Compound, where I've had a little bit of action I've had. That's about here. And obviously this is out of bounds here because people live on here. And you've got this Telegraph Bay here, which has got a couple of little swims in it. And Speedboat Point, or Jet Ski Point as it's called there. Very famous swim where Tom Stokes had the common from. Round here, this is all up in the shallows. That's the Bayliff's Point. That's the island Greg Ellis caught the common off, which is now out of bounds. And then you just got all these little channels and bays. You can see when I say it's so mazy. This bit here, like getting out on his Otter's Point, you always get lost going this way. There's little swims dotted around on both sides of this. But yeah, you've got all these little cut-throughs. And this cut-through here, that's Goose Point there. And the fish, when they get on the dog leg, they have to come through this channel here. It opens up into Weedy Bay, and then you've got loads of little islands. And like, yeah, it's a bit crazy, really. It's just like a canal that goes all the way up here, and it finishes up back here, you know. And the fish do occasionally get all the way up there and come back. Thing is, there's otters on the lake the last few years. So like people say, they ain't silly, these fish. There's a few of them being nobbled, as that one I had the other week, you see, you know, it's got a few marks. There's half a dozen in Burghfield that have been attacked by otters and survived, and obviously there's quite a few that didn't survive, unfortunately. So the fish, they know they're in there, and they don't like getting trapped, obviously, so they don't get up in these channels as much as they used to, by all accounts, because obviously once they're in them, they can get trapped quite easily by the otters, so I tend to leave them alone a bit more, but not to say at points they won't get up there. And yeah, coming out of here, you've got Barnets, which is sort of, I showed off it did a knot on the other week, that's a sort of cut through from this end into this end. They come through here. You've also got this little pit too, which is, I don't know, it'd be probably, I'd say maybe 7-8 acres, and it's a tiny little 2 foot deep channel that leads into it. You wouldn't think fish would get through it because it's very small, but they do. So there'll be a lot of looking this week coming up. We've looking at the forecast like we always do. Yeah, it's warming up about 18 degrees in the days. A little bit of sun maybe, a bit cloudy. Just generally getting a bit warmer. So hopefully they're going to be venturing up this end a bit more because it has been a bit swimmy so far, you know. They sort of, the fish are predominantly, from what I can make out, there's probably been fish caught up this end we don't know about. But in general, so far, the fish have seemed to have stained most of April, definitely, and quite a bit of May down this end, you know. So, yeah, I won't be getting there till late this week. Sort of, I'll come straight off nights. So usually after nights, so I have a night at home with the missus. But it sort of falls all over the weekend. My day's off this time, so I'm going to do a Thursday, Friday night and do my night shift, come home, have a couple of hours. Well, probably I'll try and have about 4 hours sleep. I'll finish work at 6 o'clock in the morning. I'm going to have 4 hours sleep, 5 hours sleep, hopefully set off by about 11. Couple of hours, get up to the lake about 1 o'clock and give me plenty of time to have a good look around and try and find some fish. So, yeah, that's it. Going to be doing a couple of other things like you do today. I've got a day off of work. I've gone from days to nights. I'm on nights to nights. So, yeah, we had a bit of an hole in the waders. So we just repaired that over the last couple of days, inside and out, sealed them up. So hopefully they're good to go and going to be putting some braid on later. Got some new braid to try out. Bennett Finkin has given us some braid. I'm obviously with ESP, so I get most of my tackle off ESP and they're great with me, but ESP don't actually do a braided mainline. So, Ben kindly gave us some of the new test braid from Thinking Anglers to try out. Looks good. So, I'm going to take that off because it's sinking. Don't know, not companies, but I've got two spools I've been using on the Calder gear, the sub braid, which seems good, to be honest. And I'd one on the Fox braid, £55, which, don't get me wrong, beautiful soft braids, lovely, but it really don't seem to sink very well. And as I'm going to be casting as of, not this trip, the next trip, you know, on a proper sinking braid, so I'm going to try out this Thinking Anglers one. It's meant to sink really well, so I'm going to stick some of that on. Try and lighten up the kit even more. I'll show you that later. I'm going to have a little play around with my kit, try and ditch the rucksack and get everything on the barra. But yeah, I'll get back to that in a minute. Alright guys, I'm in the garage now, just having a bit of a sort out. Something that's really important to me, fishing these big pits, as it should be any one of the big pits as you know, is you've got to try and travel as light as possible. So I'm having a bit of a sort out. I've always been a rucksack man, you know, I keep the barrel light, but I've always carried a rucksack on my back. I'm trying to ditch that, so I'm literally lightening down the gear as much as possible. And for anyone who is interested, you might not be, but you might be, I'm going to show you what I've done. So let's flick this round. So there's my trusty old rucksack, which I've emptied. And this is what I've got now. So this is what I see as my essential kit. So I've got my kettle and plate, a towel, a casting glove, cup, couple of carp sacks, scales, spare buzzer, bank sticks, distance sticks, tripod there, my buzzers, stove, and I've got a toiletry bag which has basically got toothpaste, toothbrush, toilet roll, and there's some mozzie repellent in there as well. In here I've got my little black book, as they called it. And in here I'll keep all my notes. This goes back years, you know. I've got all my fish captures going back to 2002, I think, back on Larky 2 and the railway lake at Johnson. So this goes all the way through, logging everything, every fish I've ever caught, basically. And then, yeah, get a bit more detail later on. And as we go through, you know, weather, moon phases, weight of fish, there you go, Raysbury, no name. On the Vortex, 10th of May, spot, weather, rig, amount of bait, you get the picture. But yeah, it's good to look back on, you know. And memory like mine, you'd forget a lot of this, but yeah. That's the old Super Cassoon trip I had where we absolutely clumped them. But yeah, it was a good year, 2018. Oh, where are we? As you can see, 2018, we had a cracker, 4 UK 40s, 8 30s, then we went to Cassoon, had 32 fish out of there, so that is a cracker, so that's all in there. And then at the other end, I just got spots and that written down. There you go. Roach pit, Wingham. These are Raysbury. Leary's. Style round point. Going back to survey. So yeah. Yeah, I keep all my notes in there. What I'm going to try and do is all that stuff that's in the rucksack, all this now. Luckily, I've just had a look and it does go in. We'll go in the back pocket of this Nash Barra. So that's sort of the not so essential bit. That's the stuff that can stay on the Barra, and obviously you can get your buzzers out. But I've done that, and I'll show you what I've done with what I see as the essentials, which I want out with me all the time. I'll put them in that sticky bucket. So I'm going to load this in the Barra and then get out what's in the back bucket just to show you that. Right, that's all gone in lovely in there. So the back pocket, I've got all that tackle I just showed you. This side one, I'll stick on my camera equipment. And this one here, I've got a mozzie mesh, 5 litres of water, and a couple of pints of milk. So that goes in there, a treat. And then the bucket, which I'm going off the front of the wheelbarrow. This is all my, what I call my essentials. So, got my main tackle box, rig safe, dissolving foam, catapult, binoculars, Polaroids, head torch, receiver, little pen knife handy for opening bottles of wine and doing a tiny bit of sawing, tea, PVA. Now I've got hook baits, lighters, yeah, and a tape measure and a spoon. That's it, so that all goes in there nice. So yeah, it's all looking pretty neat. Quite happy with that. That's gonna, obviously I've just lost the bloody great rucksack off my back and got it all on the Barra, so yeah, that's gonna make things even easier. Just about spooled up with this new braid, and just thought I'd show you the best way to do it. I've always found over the years, you know, a lot of people spooled up different ways, chucking it in the lake or doing it dry or whatever, but this is something I've done for years now. And I just get a washing up bowl, pierce a couple of holes in it so the bank stick goes through and goes steady, fill it up with water, and then you get really nice resistance. You don't seem to get any line twist. Dave Elliott told me with, like, I usually use synchro when I'm using mono. He said always have it coming off the underneath of the spool like that. And obviously when you wind on, you get a nice bit of tension like that off the water. So yeah, just gonna stick this braid on, and next time we catch up, I shall be hopefully on the banks of Burghfield. I'll see you then. Well, good morning. About time I did another update, I think. Ain't really done a lot of filming lately. I missed the last trip completely. It was just one of those trips you see to fly by, the late start. I had to come up after my night shift, so I had a good kip. I didn't get up here till about 1 o'clock in the afternoon. I had a good walk round. And yeah, it was interesting. It was the first bit of sun. What was this, last week of May, I suppose? And yeah, come up, had a good walk round, and actually found some fish for once on my walk round. There was a few in a pit too. I think I spoke to you before about that. It's another little section of the water, probably, I don't know, 4 or 5 acres. And yeah, the fish were starting to get in there a bit, you know. I see about 12 fish in there, I reckon. But I had a good look, and they seemed like mainly smaller ones. So I carried on doing my lap around the lake, and I found a couple of 2 or 3 bigger fish up the other end. About as far away as you can get up in Alsatian Bay, right down the other end. So I ended up plumping for the murder swim, which is sort of, if fish are going into Alsatian,
they're sort of going to go through that water. So I did a couple of nights in the murders, but absolutely nothing happened. And yeah, it was over before it started. It does seem to fly by all the time, really. So many places to look and things to do. And yeah, the sessions do whiz by. So that was that. And I wasn't actually meant to be coming up this week. It's actually come up on a Friday. I don't usually do the weekends, but my missus had the old COVID jab, her second jab. And she was pretty rough on it last time. She said to her she wanted to go fishing, so I'm going to be laid up in bed for a couple of days. So I took the opportunity to come up yesterday, had a horrendous trip up. It was pissing down with rain, and yeah, it took me, just under 4 hours, M25. You know, it's like an absolute nightmare on a Friday afternoon. So I crawled pretty much from junction 8 and then went off country, and that was all snowed up and all, you know, all the way through. I missed the motorway, but yeah, it just took ages, about 4 hours to get here. Usually takes me about an hour and 40 minutes. So yeah, that was a bit of a nightmare. So we had a text yesterday morning saying the fish had grouped out in pit 2, had started to have a little bit of a spawn, but they were going to shut pit 2. There's no fishing in there, but the lake's still open to fish elsewhere. So I come up, kept well away from. I went and had a look in pit 2 yesterday when I got here, just to have a nose, and there was nothing spawning there at all. You know, we had a lot of rain yesterday, and it's obviously dampened them right down. And I see a few fish in there, but they weren't looking spawning at all. They were just sort of milling about, real sort of slow, you know. And yeah, so left them to it, and I did my first knot on speedboat port. I thought I'd keep well away from them. I'll turn around and show you. So this is Speedy. Yeah, nice old, nice carpy swim, this one. As you can see, that's the shallows down there. And it's just islands, little islands everywhere. Absolutely beautiful. So yeah, spin round, you've got another island there in the channel. That's another island there. With another channel then behind that. You got a Hodder's Island, and then round this side, this is sort of another sort of island. That's another island. Yeah, that's Barnett's over there, and right over the back, basically behind them trees, is Pit 2, and that's where quite a few of the fish are sort of grouping up to spawn, sort of thing. You never know, they might even be doing it again today. I haven't seen nothing. I got my rods out late last night. Had a bit of a lead around it, ain't too weedy out here, to be honest. It was quite easy finding spots. So I ended up just fishing, yes, my first night, and they're fishing pretty sort of obvious places, just where I thought if anything was moving around, it's with the sort of crossing points. So I fished one off the tip of that island, and there's a bar runs off this island, and just where it drops off, I stuck a rod there in slightly deeper water where it dropped off. Give it a go, but apart from a few tench this morning rolling, we haven't seen anything carp at all. So the speedboat come out this morning, that's been out for about an hour. So yeah, the rods are in, I've wound in, because obviously don't get caught up and get stripped of a load of it. I've got nylon there, but yeah, lose a load of expensive braid. We don't want that happening, so I'm probably gonna wipe pack everything up, maybe just leave me brolly in here to keep the swim, you know. I'm a bit unsure. I want to have a good walk now. I'm probably gonna take the camera with us and try and show you a bit more of the lake, seeing it's such a beautiful day, you know. Show you a few of the swims. I haven't actually took the camera round properly when I've been doing one with walk rounds, so yeah, seeing it's such a lovely day, it'd be nice to show you a few of these swims. So yeah, didn't bother with a brolly last night. I ain't got a lot of gear to pack up, so I'm gonna pack all this up, push it back to the van, just to make sure. I'd hate for, you know, it seems pretty safe, you'd think here, but you never know if you have your gear nicked. Yeah, be absolutely devastated. So I'm gonna pack it all up, stick it in the van, and go for a walk. And yeah, I'll show you a bit more of Burghfield soon. Right, all loaded up. As I said before, I was trying to lighten things up, the old barrel. So there it is. Yeah, a bit bulky, so I know how old George gets his a bit lighter that. But yeah, I've got everything I need there. And yeah, it's pretty easy to push, to be honest.
especially without batteries going. So, yeah, it's nicely balanced. I've got particle buckets, got plenty of five clear bait. I've got beers, obviously. Food, rods, spod rod, frying stick. The lot, it's all on there, and there's enough there for 3 days. So, yeah, she's pretty light and ready to go. Just pushing back the van. This is on the blue pool banks. There's the blue pool behind you, and this swim's called the blocks. So again, it's another one with a few islands. Sort of where I was, speedboats over there, behind these trees. It's got a little island here. As you can see, there's an island there, another one 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 there. So when people say Burghfield's a bit mazy, I think you get why they say it. Especially this end, it's incredible. I think the bloke who dug it must have been on something. There, another nice looking bit of water. It all looks nice, that's the problem here. Every bloody swim you go in looks awesome. And I'll just walk up here. There are a couple of other little swims up there, sort of fishing along this margin. But yeah, that's the main swim there. And this one up here, there's another swim up here in the shallows. What a beautiful day. Look at how hot it is. Now I've got out under the shade, it's pretty hot. So I think there's a fair chance they might actually be spawning in pit 2 today. But yeah, this is the shallows up here. Nice little pads coming up down there. Nice, eh? So after leaving the blocks, guys, you have to go away from the lake and go around the outskirts and probably about 500 yards, I suppose. Past where you park up, and now we're just walking back onto where I showed you opposite the shallows. It's got a little bridge here onto the first swim, little island swim. Pretty mad one, isn't it? Let's see. All very shallow. See the bottom everywhere. Can't see no carpies. And over there, that's the swim I was looking from before, opposite. So that's the other swim, fishes the shallows. Right, back over the bridge. You got another swim just up here. I think it's called the 30s. But yeah, this is a swim called the 30s. A few little shallow bowls and plateaus out there where that swan is. But yeah, mad swim, eh? There you go. The guys even give you directions around the lake because it's first time around, it's very easy to get lost. But yeah. Next swim around here is one called the Bailiffs. I think you start to get the picture why, so it can be very hard to track these fish down, you know. There's so many hiding places, it's ridiculous, you know. The Bailiffs, walking down this bay, down to the right of the Bailiffs. People say check the snags, well, as you see. If I've got 100 metres of snags this side, and there's 100 metres of snags the other side, and that is 100 for the lake. The old lake's like it. There's just snags everywhere. It's finding out the ones the fish use, you know. Found out when I fished Raysbury, you know, it was the same. There was snags everywhere, but there's only actually 5 or 6 sets of snags I use, and it's probably the same in here. But I'm pretty fresh on here, and I don't know any of them yet, so there's going to be a hell of a lot of looking to try and find out where they like to lay up. So we come to the fork here, so if you go straight on there, as it says, to the river, that takes you round the back of the dog leg and all the way round the back, which I'll show in a bit. But first of all, you've got this path here, which takes you up to Hodder's around the other bit of the dog leg. It's like a jungle, isn't it? So there you go, this is the very top of the dog leg. But to get into there, they have to swim miles up the channel. I showed you on the map before. But yeah, it's a crazy old maze, that's for sure. This is a little swim here. Right up in the very, very end of the dog leg. Which you see is more like a little mazy canal, you know. It goes up to there, and it goes in a massive sort of U-bend all the way around the back of this lot. But yeah, occasionally they do get up here. And the common, as you're probably aware, I know when Terry caught it, he's seen the common up here, and they do come up here now and again. So you can't actually write off anywhere, you know, you've got to look everywhere. So yeah, this is part of the dog leg, this is an island. There's a channel this side, and there's another channel the other side of this island. But it opens up a bit there, as you can see. And up there, that's that U-bend that takes you around to that bit I just showed you. This is why beautiful boys wear sort of long welding gloves pushed around here, because these stingers only just started coming up. You can imagine pushing your barrow through this lot, you're going to get absolutely smashed by them, and the brambles and all. So yeah, how carp is that? So this, to be left through here, I'll show you in a minute, that's Weedy Bay, and this is really sort of the entrance into the dog leg. These are little islands. If I zoom in over there, believe it or not, that's where Mr. Owen caught the common from, out of the margin over there. So yeah, he did well getting it. Well, I think he got it in the net in a matter of minutes reading his book, but yeah, proper tight little swim. Right, I think they call this one the oak. I'm not sure, I think that's what they call it, don't quote me on that. And this is where it opens up. There's a lot of trees here, you can't really see this little swim here. This out here is Weedy Bay. Better view if I get down low, maybe. And yeah, you can see why I'm investing in electric barrels. I don't know if you can really get the full sense of this, but this is more like a BMX track than a path round a lake. You know, it's up, down. Savage all over the place. Oh, look at this eel. Hey, I pushed that eel. I don't think I'm not relishing it if I ever do. That's a proper steep eel there. Check that out. Anyway, yeah, and another big eel. Like I say, I'm going out onto Hodder's Point, and this is without a doubt the worst walk on the lake with your gear. I'll quickly show you. You've got a little swim in here, but yeah, again, it's a tiny little channel swim. Oh, spooked me. It's Hodder's Point. Yeah, you've got a section of water here, and it opens up here. That's going through the channel, past Barnett's there. And I think through here you'll be able to see, yeah, just over there, that's called Goose Point, and that bay behind it's Goose Bay.
Right, just walked back from out on Udder's Point, and we're back to the dog leg again. So now we're going back round the other way. So yeah, I might leave this running, and hopefully the guys that stick it when they edit it, they can just fast forward it, just to give you a bit of an idea how much walking you're doing, and actually how much lake you can't see. Because as I'll show you in a bit, you have to walk, I don't know, a good 600-700 yards. We're nowhere even near the lake on this bit. But yeah, here's the old dog leg. Fair bit of weed coming over here since the last time I looked in here. The next bit you get here is Terry Swim, where he had the common from. Tiny little swim in here, fair play to him. Under the broken tree. Crazy, I think. This is where Mr. Owen called the Burghfield Common from. Just out the margins in here somewhere. Well, pads have come right up since last time I looked. Oh, an old carp like it in here now and again, didn't you? Yeah, proper bit of hook and holder, that's for sure. Bloody hell. So I've not shown this before, so this is pit 2. I think I said before when I was looking at the map, it's about, I think I said about 7-8 acres, but no. In reality, it's nothing like that. It's probably about, it goes around there a bit more. It's probably 4 acres of water. But it's totally different lake to the rest, and over in that corner I'll show you in a bit, there's a very small channel, probably, I don't know, 10 foot across and 2 to 3 foot deep. And if the fish do come in here, that's the way they come through. But I'm very surprised. I thought there'd be fish looking very spawny in here, and I can't see a thing. Which is actually good news. Very good news. Hopefully it gives people... Might be boring to some, but I'm sure some people would like to see what the lake's like, and doing this gives you a bit of an idea how mazy it is. Why people say here they could be anywhere, because they really could. It's so split up. So there's a little swim in here, believe it or not, for all these stinging nettles. Ouch. Yeah. So, this is Weedy Bay. I think this is called the Ant Swim. Again, I still ain't sure, 100% sure on all the names of the swims yet. But yeah, when I was looking before, one I thought was the Oaks, that's over there opposite. But again, a red hot day like a day, and you see, we've walked around a hell of a lot of water so far, I've shown you. And yeah, I'm not filming all of it, I'm having a good look. And I ain't seen bugger all. You'd think you'd see a few fish with their backs out, wouldn't you, mooching about, but I ain't seen a thing yet. But yeah, I'm gonna do a full lap of the lake. I shall probably go back to the riverbank after I've had a look out on Goose Point and whatever. And then I shall leave the lake and walk along the canal. You sort of have to leave the lake for probably, don't know, getting on for a 3/4 mile walk to walk back to where you park up the bomb and get in the lake that way, but that's that old section that's out of bounds. We're not allowed anywhere near it, so you have to leave the lake completely, walk along some roads and some canal, and then come back onto the lake. Another corner in weedy. Snags, 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 snags. Everywhere you look, we've got snags, people. Water's murking up a bit. The water has been gin clear so far this year. It's starting to get a little tinge in it. Hope we don't colour up too much. Obviously, it makes it a bit harder for spotting them. Yeah. I might not even walk out there, but over there, that's Goose Point. Just sort of get an idea where that is in relation. And Barnett's is behind that tree over there. Yeah, let's just walk around, show the entrance to pit two, and then I think that's pretty much it covered, you know. Hopefully I'll be showing you other bits of the lake when I'm actually fishing them, but I wanted to do this little walk round just to give people a bit of an idea of where I'm talking about in relation to the map I showed you. Still muddy around here. So, believe it or not, this is the entrance. So what's that? It's not even 10 foot, it's probably about 8 foot across. See, but it's out hard to see, there's a bit, but it's probably, I don't know, it's only 2 foot, 2-3 foot deep. There you go, that's the entrance, and then it opens up into there. And obviously, into the main lake there for all these branches and trees, but yeah, you know what these carp are like, if they want to go somewhere, they'll get there. Well, I'm just going to look in this little corner, because yesterday when I walked around, I did see an handful of fish just milling about in this corner. You know, they definitely had a little go, cut the, well, yeah, what was it, night before last, I think. Yeah, I see a few fish around here yesterday afternoon, but they weren't in any way spawning. They were just sitting there milling about, like I said. I can't see bugger all here now. Just had another look back in this tent swimming pit, so yeah, there are a couple of fish in here. After all, I don't think there's loads in here. I don't think there's as many as was in here, apparently. Yeah, can't really say how big they are, but yeah, just having a little cruise about. Small fish by the looks of it. I can sort of see them. They look like 20s, them ones. Right, guys, just walked along the canal, along the roads, past the old cutting man. Very tempted to go in there for a pint, I must admit, but it's absolutely heavy. So we give that a miss, and here we're back on the lake. And this is a no carp bay. The weeds come right up in here. But yeah, I had a good looking pit, so I only see them four fish in there. I had a proper old mooch about, and I really don't think there's hardly anything left in there. So, without seeing nothing at the far end at all, hold up the shallows. Obviously, they can be in some of them snags, you're not going to see them, but I get the feeling the bulk of them have moved back down this end, so I'm kind of thinking we're probably going to find a few fish down here in Alsatian Bay. If not, I ain't got a bloody clue where they're hiding. But yeah, there's got to be fish down here, surely. I don't think I've shown this part of the lake on film before, but this is this is the bottom of Alsatian Bay. Obvious cruisers out there yet, but yeah, I'm gonna stand here for 10 minutes and have a look. But yeah, give you an idea. Up through them gaps, that's where the murder swims I fished a bit. Or when I walked around last week, I did see three fish down here, three bigger fish, which is why, you know, sometimes they come down here, they move out of the night, which is why I plumped a fish a few hundred yards up there in the murders. But nothing happened on that trip, but yeah, I forgot to mention earlier, on my second day, I did actually have a group of about a dozen carp popped up in the swim, sort of started cruising around, about 70 yards out, so yeah, so I didn't move about at all, just did me two knots in there, looked really good, but they only sort of hung around for 3 or 4 hours, and they seemed to have melted off somewhere else, so that was it. Oh, peeps, very last bit. I think this is the only bit of the lake I ain't shown you. So here's another little lake in itself of a couple of acres called, this is a Telegraph Bay. There you see, not the best viewing angle from there. But yeah, this is Telegraph Bay. And the main body of water out there, that's the Barnett's water on the other side of this. So yeah, just showing that. So, I've just done an old lap of the lake. What's that? It's now 2:30, left about 10 o'clock. So yeah, 4 hour walk round, and apart from them four fish in pit two, I couldn't find nothing, but apparently it's a bit worrying because it shows that my eyes must be really shit, because just got a WhatsApp group. They're shutting the lake, fish have been seen spawning elsewhere, and they're shutting the lake, so yeah, I'm off home to Kent, so I couldn't find anything to go on anyway, so I probably would might have buggered off anyway. But yeah, I don't know where they are. I think apparently they've been out in the main bit of water, which I couldn't really see a lot from there. So yeah, that's it, a couple of weeks. I think the lake's shut for a couple of weeks, so this is going to be my last view of the beautiful Burghfield for a little bit. And we leave them in peace, get all that out of the way, and I'll be catching up with you in a couple of weeks.
Oh, people, I ain't done an update for a bit. It's now Friday, what is it? I don't know the date, it must be, it's the 18th of June. The lake's just over, it's been shut last time I reported on. I was sort of, they shut the lake on me, didn't they, on that day, you know. I did that trip, I did 6.5 hour driving up there. And to get there and get back, and only actually fish for 12 hours, but yeah, someone seemed to start to spawn somewhere, so they shut the lake, and it's been shut for 2 weeks. It opened up today. A few of my mates are up there, I haven't actually spoken to them yet. It's a bit wet out there today. I ain't seen how they're getting on, but I haven't actually been up there. I know a few of the boys have probably been up there baiting up and that, but as I'm new on the lake, I don't really see the point. As much as I wanted to go up baiting up, I don't really see a lot of point going up at the moment, because I don't know the summer spots, you know, where I want to put bait. There's no point chucking it in willy-nilly in areas that the fish ain't visiting a lot. So yeah, I've held back a bit. I've just had a delivery of bait. I've opened it up in a sec from the Stick, you just sent me down a big bait delivery. I don't think I've ordered for 6 months. I've just ordered a load. I've got about 80 kilo boiling, 40 kilo of bloodworm pellets. So that can see me through to, at least into the autumn, without a doubt. So yeah, it's that time of year now. I want to start getting a bit in, you know. So just show you what we've got here, what I'll be using. I
Yeah, bloodworm pellets in there. So we got a load of them. This is a smaller bag. They're crew active. So what I've done as I was doing earlier, I've stopped doing the vortex now, sticky, but so I've mixed it up. I'm really, like this gear here, crew active, I've been using it on and off for years, like out in Cassine or whatever. Great bit of bait, I love it. Sort of last year I was using it on a walk I'm not going to publicise at all, you know, but I had a hell of an autumn on there using this stuff and the new Calanus liquid, you know, I had a... Yeah, I won't mention the lake or anything about it, but I ended up having four big forties out in a couple of months last autumn, which was a right nice result, really nice fish as well, really, really pleased with them. And whether it makes a difference, that Calanus liquid, or not, I don't know, but I was adding it all the time. I've got a couple of other mates been using it, and yeah, results have been really good when we've been adding it. So yeah, this is the one I love, the old krill, you know, but I'll be honest, I've not done a lot with the Manila over the years, but mates have done well, and going on to Burghfield, you know, you try and do a bit of history, and that old Cobbin seems to like a nut or a nutty bait, so I thought, you know what, I'm going to really mix up. Plus that Manila, I've never give it a fair chance, I only use it in the winter, usually, and yeah, I'm just going to mix the two together, sort of all different, all three sizes, couple of baits, and yeah, stick it in together with particles as well, and the bloodworm pellets, they love them everywhere I've took them, you know. The bloodworm pellets, they're sank in that coating, it's a bit special though, they are good. So yeah, there we got a bit of this. In actual fact, I think I'm going to be filling the freezer right up, but I don't know what's in each box. I was going to show you the liquids. Some other goodies in here. So hemp oil, always good, love adding that to my hemp and whatever. Calanus liquid seems superb, to be honest, love the smell of that. I don't think the missus does, but I do. And good old salmon oil, you know, love that on my fish meals this time of year, you know. Nice bit of oil coming up through the water layers, I'm sure it brings the fish in. What else we got? Oh yeah, and I haven't seen these yet. So this is the first, this is the new active wafters and tough ones. A lot of work's going on these apparently. They smell superb, they really do. Exactly like the bait, nice coating on them, toughened up. They're the wafters, yeah. I wish you'd smell them, they're very nice. And we've got some of these tough ones as well. Sounds like I've got a road sweeper coming out of my salad here. Yeah, he's gone past there. So yeah, it's for these hook baits. They're gonna go in the barra bag. Obviously, as you know now, the crayfish are a real problem up there. So, as much as I would absolutely love to be using these, I'll be keeping them for sort of stalking opportunities when I can sort of, yeah, if they arise, when I can sort of see me rig and whatever. You just can't risk it, you know, I ain't gonna be leaving a bait out. Even though these are tougher than them crayfish have anything, you gotta use plastic baits, you know, overnight. So I won't be taking no risks, but I can't wait to be using these because I wish it was smelly vision. I wish it was smelly, they smell brilliant. I didn't order another Manila ones yet, but I will do for later on in the year, without a doubt. Hopefully in the winter I'll give them a little go as well. So yeah, that's it. I'm going to get all this stuff in the freezer, sort my gear out. I unfortunately can't get up the lake for a few days. I'm in the middle of work. I've got a few nights to do at work. But yeah, I ain't done no fishing. I did a quick overnighter down on the local lake. Didn't do no good. In fact, I got on quite a few fish, but they sort of melted off as it got dark, I think, because nothing happened. But yeah, they're getting the gear ready now, so I'm ready to go. I haven't got a lot to do, sort of ready from last time. And yeah, last couple of weeks have been spent doing stuff on the house. I've done me, I sorted out my block paving, done a few things on my days off, sorted out the house, got a few brownie points off the missus. So yeah, we're ready to crack on and see what the summer brings. So I shall catch up with you next time, hopefully, on when I'm bankside. See you then.
Morning, time for a little update. I ain't been able to get the video out. I've been down for a little bit actually. I've just done two nights. But yeah, it's a proper old rush around. I got up late on Sunday, about 7:30. And yeah, I just walked it into the dark until about 11:30. I was walking, didn't see a lot, and ended up dropping in the murder swim for the night, just flicking a couple in close, getting my head there. Got the rods out about 1:00, proper late one. And yeah, nothing happened down there. It's reeled in about 11:00 yesterday morning. Went for a walk in the rain, pissing down yesterday again, and walked it for 6 hours and didn't actually see any carp. But after all that, I just see one little bit of interesting fizzing in an area. I thought it might be carp rather than tench, you know, it looked like carp fizz to me. So that's all I had to go on. It was in front, it wasn't even in front of a swim, it's sort of in front of a, well, it was a swim, it's one of them ones that's been not fished for years, up really overgrown. So I dropped in here last night and can't believe it, I've had one. I've got it looks like a 20 pound common. So happy days, I'll show you that in a bit. So yeah, that was a nice little hunch move, that one. I'm from a proper tiny little area. So yeah, quite rewarding fish, that one, after all that looking. So happy days.
Cheers, guys. Last Burghfield common. Show you the other side. That'll do nicely.